God said, I have surely seen the oppression of my people who are in Egypt, and I have also heard their cry. Like a shepherd rescuing his sheep, God commands Moses to go back to Egypt and tell Pharaoh, let my people go so that they may serve me. Moses comes to Pharaoh. Pharaoh does not listen, refuses to let the people go, and God sends the first of a series of spectacular plagues against the land of Egypt.
In Exodus chapter 5, the God of Israel says, let my people go. Pharaoh says, who is the Lord? Who is Jehovah? Who is Yahweh that I should listen to him? And so we have setting up there this contest. Who really is the God to be obeyed? Who is the one in control of things? And in the Egyptian view of things, Pharaoh was the God of the Egyptian state. He was responsible for cosmic order. He was responsible for the proper flow of the Nile, the rising of the sun, the fertility of the fields, and so on. And now we have the God of Israel, the God of creation of the Bible, who's saying, no, wait a minute, that's not what you do. I'm the one who controls all these things. So he begins with the Nile and ends in the ninth plague with the sun. And these two things that Pharaoh is said to control are completely outside of his control.
God protected the children of Israel from these plagues, while the rest of the land was being devastated by them, to where Pharaoh's servants themselves pleaded with him, saying that this was the finger of God and that Egypt was being ruined. But Pharaoh would not relent. He knew that Egypt depended on the work of these foreign slaves.
In Israel, Mahoney also had the privilege to speak with the prime minister. Although seen by most as a political figure, Benjamin Netanyahu was also an author and historian, like his father.
Tell me about the effect the Exodus has had upon civilizations in the last 3,000 years.
Moses was the greatest revolutionary of all time. Remember that in antiquity there were grand empires that were based on one principle, and that is slavery. And Moses challenged that twice. He challenged it by taking his people who were slaves in bondage in Egypt and freed them, took them to their promised land. But he also challenged it by providing a code, a moral code, for mankind that said that it is not the king or the emperor that decides the law. There's a higher law. And these were absolutely revolutionary ideas.
The text then says that God sent the 10th and final plague to force Pharaoh's hand. The death of the firstborn of man and beast. The Lord told the Israelites that each household was to slaughter a lamb and mark the doorpost with the blood of the lamb. And on that horrible night, death passed over all the homes marked with blood. But in every home that wasn't marked, all the firstborn males died. There was crying and wailing in every Egyptian home because each family had lost someone.
The 10th plague, the death of the firstborn, affected everybody. Even Pharaoh's firstborn died that night, and the will of the people, the Egyptians, was completely shattered. The 10th plague broke Pharaoh's defiance of God, and he finally let Moses and the people go. But then Pharaoh changes his mind, pursues the Israelites with his army, and at the sea, God parts the water so that the Israelites can escape while it destroys the entire Egyptian army.
Written by a scribe named Ippower, the papyrus known as the Admonitions of an Egyptian Sage poetically describes a series of calamities and the chaos that followed.
Ippower. We don't know who he was, but he was obviously somebody in a position to address His Majesty, the King. There's only one copy of this specific text, and that is here in the Leiden Museum. It's a very, very vivid report, or would-be report, of what happens to Egypt when the central power falls away.
Many believe a collapse of Egypt's power is exactly what would have happened due to the plagues of Exodus. And as I compared the Book of Exodus to the writings of Ippower, I too was intrigued by the similarities.
To convince Pharaoh, God says, take some water from the Nile and pour it on the ground. And as it hits the ground, it will turn into blood.
Behold, Egypt is fallen to the pouring of water. And he who poured water on the ground seizes the mighty in misery.
And all the water in the Nile turned into blood. And the fish of the Nile died, and the Nile reeked, so that the Egyptians could not drink water from the Nile.
The river is blood. If you drink of it, you lose your humanity and thirst for water.
All the livestock of the Egyptians died. Fire ran down from heaven, and the Lord sent hail upon the land. Even the flax and the barley were smitten.
Gone is the barley of abundance. Food supplies are running short. The nobles hunger and suffer. Those who had shelter are in the dark of the storm.
At midnight, the Lord struck down all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, from the firstborn of Pharaoh sitting on his throne to the firstborn of the captive in the dungeon.
Behold, plague sweeps the land. Blood is everywhere, with no shortage of the dead. He who buries his brother in the ground is everywhere. Woe is me for the grief of this time.
And there was great wailing throughout the land of Egypt, for there was not a house without its dead.
Wailing is throughout the land, mingled with lamentations.
Moses told the Israelites to ask the Egyptians for silver and gold jewelry and for clothing.
People are stripped of clothes. This slave takes what he finds. Gold, lapis lazuli, silver, and turquoise are strung on the necks of female slaves.
The Lord gave the people favor in the sight of the Egyptians, so they gave them whatever they asked. Thus they plundered the land of Egypt.
So this is the famous Merenptah Stela, or what we call the Israel Stela. And it actually belongs to the king Merenptah. Up there at the top, you can see him facing the god Amun. And he lists in a poetic form all the different conquered nations, the nations that are at peace. But right at the bottom, we have three crucial lines, because this is where we find a link to the Bible.
Let's read it together, okay? We have two reeds. That's the sound Y or E, okay? Then a bolt, which is S, an R, a mouth, an E, an A, and an L. Israel.
Israel.
Israel. This is the only time that we see this name and this on an Egyptian monument. After the name Israel, there are these two figures here, these two seated figures of a woman and a man, and three strokes underneath. These three strokes mean plural. So it means the people or nation of Israel. And then this is the interesting bit. It says, Fekti bin Peret F. Israel is laid waste. His seed is no more.
Well, does it mean they were literally no more?
No, it's a sort of poetical way of saying they've been overcome, defeated.
Like pacified?
All these phrases here are like that. It's a poetical phrase, effectively.
Charles Ayling brought him to see his colleague, historian Clyde Billington, who has extensively researched this newly discovered find.
Besides the Merneptah Stele, there's another reference to Israel. It's called the Berlin Pedestal. It's in the State Museum in Berlin, Germany. And this is something that's just now being studied and discussed by scholars.
On the base of this Egyptian statue, they showed Mahoney name rings, each representing an enemy defeated by Pharaoh in the region of Canaan.
So would these have been captured people?
Realize that pharaohs all the time exaggerate, to say the very least.
So is he bragging?
He's bragging.
Okay.
He's bragging. He's saying, I've conquered these people, I control these people. This is the one that's caused all of the excitement, because you have, again, a bound enemy. So telling you that these people are enemies of the Egyptians. And the name down here, that while it's partially broken away, has been reconstructed, and it's the name Israel.